Praise God. Praise God. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, a Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we edify, we exalt, and we challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we have a very solid, beautiful topic. All our topics, they are always solid and beautiful. Praise God. Because the Holy Spirit himself gives them to us. But today is of a very special, beautiful topic. It's titled, The Heart of Christianity. The Heart of Christianity and the Case Study. Is going to be our Lord Jesus, beautiful Jesus, and the Pharisees. So that should interest you, right? And the short reading is 1 Corinthians 13, chapter 1 to, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 to 13. 1 Corinthians 13, verse 1 to 13. Let us pray. Father, we thank you. Thank you, O Lord, for your love. Thank you for the miracle of life. Thank you for bringing us here to learn from your feet again. Sweet, blessed Holy Spirit, take these lips of clay and use them for your glory, for the glory of Jesus, that the whole counsel of God will be declared. And let your word have a free course in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Our foundation text is the gospel according to Luke, chapter 10, verse 42. Luke 10, 42. But this is Jesus speaking to Martha. But one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen that good part, which will not be taken away from her. This happened, if you're a Bible student, you know the occasion. Martha thought cooking mattered, you see. And she was fussy about that. And Jesus was correcting her because Mary was sitting next to Jesus, listening. What a privilege. Listening one-on-one to Jesus preach, you see. So what is the heart of Christianity? First, I'm going to talk about what the heart of Christianity is not. Two things. Then we are going to talk about the last two things, which the heart of Christianity is. So, the heart of Christianity is beyond good words. Jesus preached and taught at every opportunity he had with people. He was very clear about his mission. And part of that mission was to tell us about the Father in heaven, and about heaven. However, Jesus did not stop at speaking good words to people. Track with me. In form of teaching them spiritual truth alone. Listen up. The heart of Christianity is not good preaching. Since any gifted orator can pretend and preach. Some people, they are naturally gifted in public speaking, you see. So if they pick up the Bible or they start to talk about a topic in the Bible, that doesn't mean they have the heart of Christianity. No. The Pharisees were consistently and sharply rebuked by the Lord. Why? For their failure to put their money where their mouth was, you see. Jesus is very clear throughout the scriptures that the heart of Christianity is not in words. Let's go to Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 23. We are going to read verse 2 to 3. We are going to read it in Good News Translation. Matthew 23, 2 to 3. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees are the authorized interpreters of Moses' law. In other words, they are the experts. They know how to interpret the Mosaic law that God gave. So you must obey and follow everything they tell you to do. This is Jesus telling the people to listen and obey and follow everything that the Pharisees tell them, okay? However, do not imitate their actions, because they don't practice what they preach. You see that? The Pharisees were full of good words because they were talking about the word of God, okay? But they don't practice it. And Jesus said, don't follow them. Follow what they say, but don't follow what they do, because they're only full of good words. To be good with God's word does not prove to be good with God at all. Let me say that again. To be good with God's word does not prove that you are good with God at all. Moving on. The heart of Christianity is beyond good works. Good works are commendable, okay? As bad, listen up, as the Pharisees were, Jesus commended their good works of searching the scriptures, indeed, and of paying tithe. Jesus commended them. He's a balanced God, you see. Nevertheless, Jesus went on to condemn the Pharisees for leaving undone what they should have done. Jesus made it clear that the Pharisees had their spiritual priorities wrong. Are you getting this? So don't let anybody cheat you or deceive you because they can preach, they know how to speak good words about Jesus. That doesn't mean they have the heart of Jesus or the heart of Christianity. And don't let anybody deceive you because they do some good works. No, follow this, please. When it comes to the heart of Christianity, the Bible says good works are not good enough, because on the day of judgment, many will claim to have done good works for Jesus, you see. And in the name of Jesus, they've done it. Yet, Jesus will still disown them, and they will still go to eternal damnation. Let's go to Matthew chapter 7, verse 21. Matthew 7, 21. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? Now, listen to the next verse and hear what Jesus has to say. And then I will declare to them, this is Jesus speaking, I never knew you. Who are you? I don't know you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Another version says, you who practice iniquities, you see. So that somebody is healing people in Jesus' name, or feeding people in Jesus' name, and helping people to build their, repair their houses, in Jesus' name, it doesn't mean they have the heart of Christianity. No. Good works without God's law becomes good for nothing after all. We are going to say that very slowly, together, okay? Because if you are doing something and it's not in line with the word of God, the way God wants his job done, then it becomes good works without God's law. This is God's law. It becomes good for nothing after all. So we have talked about what the heart of Christianity is not. It's beyond good words. It's beyond good works. Now let's see the third one. The heart of Christianity belongs to good God. Hallelujah. The heart of Christianity is not in the custody of anyone except with God himself. You can't find it anywhere. No. God will only give the heart of Christianity to genuinely saved believers. Please, please, I need your attention at this point, because so many children of God have been deceived into salvation with works. So we need to learn what the Lord himself is telling us. We need to know. They believe, yes, Jesus saves, but you have some works to do before Jesus can save you. The devil is a liar. We are saved by grace through faith, not by works of righteousness which we have done, the Bible says. No. You see. So the heart of Christianity is with God alone, and he only gives it to genuine believers. And God does this for two reasons. Number one, for easy identification of a true believer by others. Number two, to authenticate the originality of such believers' faith. That is how you are going to know yourself. You will be convinced that, oh yeah, I know I'm saved, because God has given you the heart of Christianity. Jesus exposed the Pharisees as spiritual phonies and frauds because they lack this one quality, which can only proceed from God. All through the scriptures, we are told whoever does not possess this quality does not belong to God, you see. No matter who they claim to be, doesn't matter, I like to say it, it doesn't matter if you are the bishop, the archbishop, the pastor, the chief pastor, the pope, it doesn't matter what title you choose to wear. If you don't have this one quality from God in your life, you are nothing. You are nothing. With all your regalia that you put on before your people, your parishioners, if you don't have that insignia of God in your heart, God says, who is this? You are a rogue, parading yourself as a priest, you see. All through the scriptures, we are told whoever does not possess this quality does not belong to God, no matter who they claim to be. Jesus called the Pharisees, listen now, for all you people that say, oh, Jesus is kind, Jesus doesn't judge people. Jesus is kind, he's love, okay? But he is a true God that will tell it as it is. Jesus called the Pharisees the children of hell. Hello? Because they did not possess the heart of Christianity, which only God can give to those who belong to him. Let's go to one of my favorite verses in the Bible, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19. If you're a Bible student, you're already thinking, what is that? I think that sounds familiar. Yes, it is. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19. Nevertheless, hallelujah, the foundation of God standeth sure. Hallelujah. Having this seal. The seal is the heart of Christianity that we are talking about. The Lord knoweth them that are his. God knows who are his own people. God knows who are his own children. Like, I know how many children I have. It doesn't matter how many people call me mom. I know my children, you see. God knows his children. And let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Listen up. God knows his people. Oh, yeah. You can deceive yourself. You can deceive other people. But you cannot deceive my God. Hallelujah. So if you don't have a seal, a symbol on you today, if you don't have the heart of Christianity, there's still time. You can repent right here, right now. You can only serve with what you have. Let's say that again. You can only serve with what you have. If you don't have the heart of Christianity, you can't serve Christianity to people around you because you don't have it, you see. Now, I guess I put you in suspense long enough. What is the heart of Christianity? Are you ready? Okay, let's go. The heart of Christianity is, listen up, the love for true God. Love for true God. Jesus called the Pharisees whitewashed tombs and hypocrites. Jesus declared woe against the Pharisees on many occasions because they were more concerned about keeping the law than possessing the love of God, you see. A true believer, listen up, we have true love for Jesus. Because this kind of, please listen to me, this is very critical. This kind of love for Jesus can only be given by God. You see, when someone genuinely, I mean genuinely, gives his or her heart to Jesus at salvation, are you tracking with me? Watch this. When you see yourself as a wretched sinner, totally depraved, that you cannot please the perfect God, and it demands perfection for everyone that will come to heaven, and you know that you cannot meet that requirement, and you say, Jesus, I heard you can help me, that you can be my ticket to heaven. I give you my life. When you do that from the bottom of your heart, then God put his love into your heart at salvation. You see, you don't respond to salvation because you love Jesus. No. I didn't respond at salvation to Jesus because I love Jesus. No. He loved me, but I didn't love him at that point, you see. But I needed help. Spiritually, I was on my highway to hell at the time. And mentally, I was breaking down. So I needed Jesus. Emotionally, I was a total wreck, you see. And the Bible says Jesus can help you. And I said, okay, Jesus, if you can, here I am, a complete mess. I don't know what you can do with me, but I give you my heart, you see. And then there was this supernatural surgical operation, spiritual operation that took place. And by this supernatural operation, whereby Jesus will now put his love into your heart at salvation, it becomes possible for such a believer to to live the kind of life of obedience to the word of God that Jesus expects his followers to live. A lot of people are confused when the Bible says we have to live holy. But it's difficult. The reason why it's difficult for you to live a holy life, even though you're a baptized church person, is because the love of Jesus has not been put in your heart. That is why it's difficult. Jesus will never ask us to do what we cannot do or what he has not equipped us to do. So if you are finding it difficult, you are always 2 years of Christianity and then 5 years as an adulterer, and then you come back again, you are still not saved. If you have been saved, that supernatural operation will have changed your heart. Jesus will have put his love in your heart, and you will have found it so difficult to move away from him, you see. I wish I had the time. When I was preparing this message, I remember this young lady, 15-year-old, Leah Sharibu, her name is called. And please, if you're a believer, pray for that girl. Her name is Leah. Right now, she's with a jihadist. She was kidnapped with a classmate. And her classmate had been released over a month ago. But Leah is still with this people, jihadists, because she refused to renounce a Christian faith. The other girls, they were released because they converted to Islam. And Leah said, no, it's not going to happen, you see. The dad, when he was interviewed, he said, I'm happy that the other girls are back, but I'm sad because my girl is not here. But at the same time, I'm happy that she didn't renounce a Christian faith. Why did that young girl, 15-year-old, why didn't she renounce Jesus in the face of gun-toting jihadists? It's because the love of Christ has been placed in the heart of that girl, and she couldn't just see herself renouncing and denouncing Jesus. Oh no, you see. The love of God we manifest in what we do. We will love what Jesus loves and hate what he hates. That's why you can walk with somebody who is a homosexual in your company and not hate them. But at the same time, you will tell them the truth. If they want to know, if they ask you, will homosexuals get to heaven, or liars, or adulterers, or fornicators? Then you say, no, they can't, because the Bible says no. But that doesn't mean when they come next to your desk at your workplace, then you walk off. No, that's the love of Jesus, you see. Because the love of Jesus will be walking through you to call them to repentance. A genuine follower's heart desire will be to satisfy Jesus. That's the number one thing. To satisfy Jesus, our mind will be to think and behave like Jesus. A heart that has the love of Jesus will only engage in physical actions such that Jesus himself will engage in. The story is told of a man that became saved. Before he was a believer, he used to gamble. And so his friends at work, they said, come on, let's gamble. And he said, no, I can't. And they said, why? Why not? He said, because I don't have hands. And they're like, are you okay? Nothing happened to your hands. Come on, let's go. He said, no, these are not my hands anymore. They are the hands of Jesus. And Jesus does not play, he doesn't gamble. You see, that is a man who has received the heart of Christianity, the love of Jesus, from God. We may not do all this perfectly, always. No, I always tell people, if you are looking for a perfect Christian, then you are looking at the wrong person, okay? But I, by the grace of God, I am a growing Christian. I'm confident in Christ Jesus to tell you that I'm no longer struggling this year with what I used to struggle with last year, because I'm growing, you see. If indeed we have the love of God in us, we will be progressing. We are not going to be perfect, but we will be progressing. Possessing a true love for God is the heart of Christianity. That's what it's all about. It is the foundation, the root, and the pillar of Christianity. That's it. The love for God is the mark of identification that Jesus asked us to look for in people. Anyone that says, I'm a Christian, keep watching them. Keep watching their lives. Because if they are truly saved, if they are genuine believers, they will love what Jesus loves. And they will hate what he hates. The fruit of the Spirit can only come from a heart that has a genuine love for God. This is how those who have been religious or only had a spiritual experience but not truly saved are exposed over time. I was speaking to somebody a couple of months back, and she was telling me that there were some people when they were in college, they were on fire for Jesus. They were leading the student Christian fellowship. But after they changed, after they finished college, they went haywire. And I said, so what happened? Did they lose their salvation? Huh? But the thing is, a lot of children of God have been confused with stuff like that. See, people can have spiritual experience, okay? And God ministers to people in order to draw them to himself. So their heart may be tender at a point in their lives. Maybe they are going through stuff and their heart becomes tender. And the Holy Spirit will begin to minister to them, to draw them with God's love so they can become saved. But if deep down in their heart, maybe their problem is solved, now everything is good, and they were not really saved all along when they were doing all those religious duties and having those religious experiences, that is why you see them 4 years later, 5 years later, 10 years later, they've turned crazy. It's because the seed was never there. No, they were just sober for a while, that's all. All other things we cease or stop, but love never stops. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. Deuteronomy 6, 5. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God, hallelujah, with all thine heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy might. That is the pillar, the foundation, and the heart of Christianity. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 13. One of the verses that you are going to read in your short reading. It says, and now abide faith, hope, love. These three, but the greatest of these is love. You only need faith here as a child of God. You only need hope here as a child of God. When we get to heaven, you won't need faith anymore. You won't need hope anymore. But our love for Jesus, we just beginning. We just be starting, you see. So love is forevermore. Love for God is his heart displayed in our acts for a lifetime. Underscore the lifetime, please. Let me say that slowly. Love for God is his heart displayed in our act for a lifetime. If you have known somebody for 80 years, if they have the heart of Christianity, they will still keep being a genuine child of God. If they are falling away and they didn't come back, listen, they were never saved. Okay? So what is the heart of Christianity? The heart of Christianity is beyond good words. That is, knowing how to preach is not God's seal of approval that someone is truly saved. It's beyond good works. Doing good Christian works does not mean true salvation. It belongs to good God. The heart of Christianity can only be received from God. The heart of Christianity is the love for true God. This is the love that God puts in the heart of a believer at salvation, so that a life of holiness unto the Lord for a lifetime will be possible. So, based on this lesson, can you confidently say you're a legitimate follower, child of Jesus Christ, or not? If your answer is yes, continue the good fight of faith. If your answer is no, there's still room to repent and become a genuine believer indeed. Now, if you're a pagan or a pagan Christian, you've never considered Jesus in your heart, you're just keeping up appearances, listen, Jesus loves you. Oh yeah, he loves you. He loved you, and that's why he died for you. You can respond to that love by inviting him into your heart. He will save you and take you places you never dreamed of spiritually. Now, if you are ready, a link is coming up. Follow that link as soon as I finish praying. God bless you. Thank you, dear Jesus. Father, your word has gone out. Let it prosper in our hearts. Let it do his work in our hearts. Help us to continue to mature in you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.